Congratulations.
From policeman to politician, Hong Kong's incoming leader John Lee is ready for the role of a lifetime. The veteran security official turned top bureaucrat is now the city's newly minted leader who takes over from Carrie Lam as chief executive. So who is the real John Lee? And how will he go about starting the new chapter he has promised? After the anti-government protest chaos of 2019 and the ravages of the coronavirus pandemic.
I describe myself as a pragmatic person. What needs to be done will be done and should be done.
Find out in this episode of Talking Post.
John Lee, Chief Executive Designate, thank you very much for joining us. Let's talk about Hong Kong's competitive edge and its status as an international financial center. You know, that's been taking a bit of a beating in recent weeks, recent months, recent years back as well. As Chief Executive, what are you going to do to reverse that trend?
So Hong Kong as a whole has a lot of strengths and attractions, which makes it a very competitive city. But we have to face one challenge, which is there have been a lot of fear-mongering and bad-mouthing political maneuvers, which somehow paint a picture which doesn't reflect the actual situation in Hong Kong. What we need to do is tell people the true Hong Kong. So what I intend to do is, first of all, we do our own things better. That is, we improve our competitiveness by strengthening our attraction and values ourselves and to the world. And then we tell people about it. I will be sending delegations, officials, and also people in different sectors to go outside Hong Kong to tell the world what Hong Kong actually is operating, what Hong Kong is like, so that people understand, despite the fear-mongering or bad-mouthing exercise because of political reason, this is Hong Kong. This is a vibrant city. This is a city which people can come and realize their dreams and potentials. We are an international city. Opportunities are a lot here. We are the gateway to mainland China. The market is there. And we have a lot of strengths.
You just spoke about sending people out to spread the message that we're open for business. And it's not as bad as people make it out to be in Hong Kong. But you yourself, I mean, as CE, that's very much part of your role as well, to promote Hong Kong overseas, an authority figure doing that. But you're under sanctions yourself. That makes it very difficult, isn't it?
I'm not worried about it. There are a lot of places I can go to, right? Only one hegemonic country has made this very unreasonable.
But that country has a lot of other countries that follow everything it does and toes the line when it says you need to sanction so and so, they have to do it. So your options are quite limited, aren't they?
Well, first of all, I think the world is large and there are a lot of places where we can develop our relationship and extend our influences and bring benefits to them and to ourselves. So the opportunities are wide open. Besides, I can have a lot of other people to go out and tell the true stories of Hong Kong.
There's APEC, for example, like regional forums. Would you go to APEC, for example?
Oh, of course. This is a forum which the chief executive has been attending. So it is an APEC activity. An APEC activity, we are a member. So I will be going.
So there's one coming up next. So that'll be...
Well, that will be my goal.
You talked also about the negative messaging about Hong Kong. A lot of it is out of your control, isn't it? It's just unfortunate that Hong Kong happens to be trapped in the middle of this larger geopolitical game between China and the US. So we're in a kind of hapless position. How much can you do?
Well, I think one thing which is important is we have confidence in ourselves so that we don't somehow forget that there are a lot of strengths and there are good things that we can do. So we have to pull our act together to be even stronger. to prove our case, to make Hong Kong even more appealing, more attractive to people of different places.
You have a battle plan, or is this just general policy that you're talking about? Or do you have specific plans to go ahead?
Well, I think we need to be both protective of ourselves and then offensive. Protective is to ensure that in this complex geopolitical situation, we have sufficient readiness to take on challenges or risks that may happen all of a sudden. Just in the same way as the threat to national security and to the whole of Hong Kong in 2019. So we have to be very prepared, have a high safety margin so that we can deal with it effectively. That is the first thing, be protective so that we can be sure. Well, whatever happens, then I can still stand up to it. That is important. The second thing is we have to be offensive, and by doing that is despite all the challenges and attacks, we still face up to the challenges, go out and tell the people, tell them the opportunities, right? We are the third largest financial center. We are in front positions in a lot of rankings regarding the competitiveness, the attraction, and all the capabilities. So we tell all these things to the world.
The government has already done all this, the stuff that you're talking about on how to improve Hong Kong's messaging. They've tried it and it hasn't worked very much. Are you going to ramp it up a bit?
Well, of course, something we can work jointly with the central authorities, because the central authorities have strong positions internationally. So we can join a lot of delegations, led by the CPG, and then of course our country also has its sphere of influence, and this is an area we can build our strength, be proactive, and achieve the best value for Hong Kong.
President Xi Jinping, I mean, he's, you know, he talks about how much he loves Hong Kong and how important Hong Kong is to him. But he's also made it a task for you that, you know, Beijing's comprehensive jurisdiction over Hong Kong, the emphasis of one country over two systems, you have to prove all that to Beijing as well. You have to carry on with that. At the same time, you also have the expectations from citizens like us. And our expectations are of the preservation of the freedoms that Hong Kong used to enjoy. Press freedom, society, freedom in society, all that. And there is a distinct perception that that is being eroded in some way or the other as journalists ourselves about press freedom. Now we have to walk a fine line. So it's a bit difficult. How are you going to meet all those expectations?
Well, I'm
you can't keep all people happy all the time, but...
I'm quite disappointed that even Yonden, you have that thinking. I tell you, who protects your rights and freedoms? First of all, the law protects your rights and freedoms, right? Okay, I'm not confident on how people apply the law. So what protects your rights and freedom in that situation? The rule of law, the court. How do we rank Hong Kong in the rule of law ranking? We are not 19. And a lot of European countries, including the US, are behind us. Are you worrying about rights and freedoms in those countries? If you don't, and our rule of law is such highly regarded, the rule of law protects your rights and freedoms. That's the first thing. So we need to tell people that. That's exactly what I want my officials, myself, and delegations from Hong Kong to go out and tell people. Yes, they are fear mongers. They tell you stories which, by repetition, even the untrue, seems to be the true situation. We need to tell them that. The second thing is, we need to build a consensus that freedom is not a blank check to contravene the law. Freedom means that everybody operates within the confines of the law so that you can enjoy the maximum freedom. Otherwise, the weaker will be exploited by the stronger. That is why we need to build the right culture of Hong Kong, the right value of Hong Kong.
Let's talk about the COVID situation in Hong Kong. We are under the ravages of a major pandemic still affecting us. And at this moment in time, more important than ever has become the need to reopen or fully reopen our boundaries with the mainland, with mainland China. But there is also a handicap or an obstacle in that sense that you can do all the policies you want on this side of the border, but you also have to be mindful of the national policy on the other side. And a lot of China's attitude towards this is almost zero tolerance, right? You have the dynamic zero COVID policy. So you're limited. How are you going to do this?
Well, I think trust is important. So I think I need to build trust so that whatever I do in Hong Kong, it will be seen as a very reasonable and practical plan to address the situation in Hong Kong locally, at the same time without bringing extra risk to the mainland. I think that is important so that whatever I do will not be seen as not in the interests of the country. The second thing is, I think the mainland authorities know the Hong Kong situation well as well. And that is my take ever since my dealing with the mainland authorities. One thing I have been very impressed with is they take Hong Kong's interests close to their heart in the same way as I always tell them, I also will take the interests of the mainland close to my heart so that we have a common purpose of formulating on doing something which will be to our mutual good. I think that's important. Of course, the first thing I need to do is talk to them so that they can tell me what will be the conditions for normal travel resumption. If we may not achieve that goal very quickly, then are there interim goals that we can achieve?
Do you have specific targets in mind? Like, can we expect maybe at least by the end of this year some kind of reopening and some kind of return to greater normalcy?
It depends on several factors, I think, which if we do ourselves, if we work hard ourselves, it will be faster. But if we don't do it well, then of course, it is something that we should reconsider. First of all, it depends on how the actual situation, the pandemic situation is in Hong Kong. Whether we can control it so that the risks will not be spreading into mainland, and whether we have sufficient measures to, first of all, protect the high-risk group, the elderly, for example. Because if we don't run our own house well, people will not have the confidence that you will not cause problem to them. So one thing I will do very quickly, together with my Secretary for Health, is a quick review, looking at statistics, looking at the figures, to ascertain how we can achieve the best result with the least cost, which is something he has highlighted in his statement when I introduced my governing team. The second thing is, what are possible interim measures, interim goals, before we can reach the final goal? In other words, yes, the quarantine period is causing inconvenience to travelers. Is there a way of addressing that inconvenience so that reduce it a little bit? These are options. But of course, we have also to understand what are being practiced in the mainland.
Now, there's also the other big elephant in the room, which is our inability to open our borders to foreign travelers. And that's a cause of great discontent among the expatriate community, in particular the business community. How are you going to strike a balance? How you have to satisfy two masters here. The mainland border opening, which is so important, and at the same time, Hong Kong's international status means people coming back and forth. How are you going to balance that?
Well, I have that issue close to my heart. I know that our connectivity with the world needs to be maintained so that we can continue our business and maintain our competitiveness. But it is a balance, as you have said, to ensure that it is difficult, but well, government's challenges are always difficult. But I'm pleased that I have the Secretary for Health, who is so professional and.
You're talking about the new one or the old one?
I'm talking about Professor Low. He is very evidence-based, and he is a man who will be able to make an objective assessment as to how things will develop. Because while I want very much to make travel into Hong Kong and out of Hong Kong as convenient as possible, I have, as I earlier explained to you, the need to protect society so that there will not be serious cases or death cases out of control. And I think everybody will agree that we don't want to see another repetition of what we experienced in February or March this year when we had a high number of deaths.
Can you guarantee that you'll make sure that kind of thing never happens again? Because it was
well,
quite
it will
traumatic.
Be our goal. It will be our goal to ensure that the elderly are well protected. It will be our goal. And the response measure, the response strategy has to work out well so that time-wise, facility-wise, we'll be ready and quick to react to the threat once it has been identified as serious so as to trigger my contingency plan.
There are so many expectations on you regarding this as well, the new leader in town. Are there going to be any, you know, the word that people like to use in this town is goodies in terms of a little bit of flexibility on the COVID quarantine restriction front? For example, allowing people to stay home to quarantine or shortening the quarantine period? Any chance that you would be more flexible?
Well, there are a lot of suggestions I've heard, and some of you have mentioned. I will look at all of them. I will look at all of them and see on balance against the risk and the need to control the high-risk group so that they will be well protected, how I can maneuver amongst all these suggestions. But as I've told you, I have all these things close to my heart. So I've heard them, I take them seriously, but I also have to take seriously to protect the protection of the high-risk group.
Let's talk a little about you yourself as a leader and your new team. You know, they call you a hardliner because you were in charge of security during the 2019 anti-government protest chaos. And I've even heard people calling you a landmine detonator. Is that a fair representation? And if you are such, what kind of landmines are you expecting to clear?
I describe myself as a pragmatic person. What needs to be done will be done and should be done. And that is me. So like COVID, they are difficult questions, but well, I have to face up to it. I don't hide behind problems. I face up to them. It is better to face up to them so that I can design solutions. If you ask about what potential threats or risks there are likely to be, I think one is the, because of the complexity of geopolitical situation, certainty of supplies, I think, is one area. Because you can see the tension in Ukraine. There are problems in different areas of supplies, including goods, including necessities. So this is a realistic threat that we have to ensure that if things do get worse out of our control, because that is the environment we are in, we have a contingency plan to deal with it. But we are lucky because we have one country, two systems. So the contingency plan is not limited to just Hong Kong locally. The contingency plan can take advantage of what can be offered by the mainland authorities.
You've described yourself as the conductor of a new symphony for Hong Kong. And you've just recently unveiled your new team who will help you achieve that. So this group of musicians or orchestra members that you've recruited, what is so special about them that you think you can make them achieve the results that previous administrations have not been able to achieve? Pardon me for being skeptical, but every chief executive before you has taken over with promises of a new chapter. They all started with that, and sorry to say, some have ended in tears. What will you do different?
Well, first of all, I want to make it very clear that every government, before my term, they try their best to serve the interests of Hong Kong. I am a believer and practitioner of teamwork, because a single person can only do as much, and it's only through synergizing and allow each other to do their best so that 1 + 1 will be greater than 2, then you can really make real achievements. The second thing is the team will be strong because we share the same belief. They all share my philosophy, which is we must be result-oriented. We must ensure that we take care of each other, collaborate and synergize. Third, leaders are very important. I expect leaders to come out to intervene early when they see a potential problem. So time will not be wasted. Energy will be focused. And also, officials and civil servants will know very clear where the goal is. When I come to thinking about my job, I ask myself, am I working with good civil servants or bad civil servants? The answer is crystal clear. They are good civil servants because for 2 years or many years, they have been ranked number one and number two in the category of government efficiency. So they must be good. So why do we have problems previously? First of all, it was during crisis time. So crisis management is an area we need to strengthen. This is why I've said I will be looking at the different contingency plan, ensure we have a high margin of safety so that next time when it comes, it's not the safety margin that we'll deal with normally on a day-to-day basis. It will be a safety margin that we strongly believe can handle the crisis. That's the first thing. The second thing is speed. Certainty is important. Rather than waiting to decide how many people I can call out to deal with this crisis, I already have a mechanism. That is why in my manifesto, I mentioned the need to create a crisis response mechanism. In 24 hours, I must have, say, 5% of the whole government to come out to do this or do that. That is certainty, and that is also speed. I think the Omicron attack has taught us a very strong lesson, is that certainty and speed are vital in fighting crisis.
After what happened in 2019 with the anti-government protests, you saw the sheer number of people on the streets. Not all of them were violent, not all of them were breaking the law. Many of them were respectable citizens who came out with genuine problems that they felt the government was not addressing. Those people have not disappeared now. You have a national security law in place, the law and order situation has been restored, but those unhappy people are not going away. They're sitting at home, they're grumbling, they're deeply unhappy, and they do oppose a lot of government policies in their minds, if not through actions. How are you going to make them feel more included? Or is it, if you're with us, you stay with us, otherwise you can move along?
Well, of course, I always want to include them. But for those who have broken the law and there's evidence that they have done it, of course...
That's a different demographic.
Yeah, well, we have to respect the system. That's the rule of law. But I will be trying to help as many people as possible. Hong Kong is inclusive, right? We always have differences. particularly when Hong Kong, as you have described, is a place where people live so freely, can think so freely and do things so freely. So they have their own way of thinking about things. So they're bound to the differences among people. But I think we should not play up the differences. We should focus on commonalities. And that is what I will be doing. I will be making use of action, of doing a lot of things for the common good of society, for their well-being, so that they will eventually trust that the government is doing things for the overall good, for their good. And slowly, through this action of doing things that will benefit them, they will see that this is a government, then they may perhaps allow it to run for an even longer time so that they can make their own judgment as whether this is a good government.
So, John Lee, Chief Executive Designate, Hong Kong's next leader, thank you very much for your time and for sharing with us your vision about leadership. Thank you.
Thank you, Yonden.